financial issues, trying to survive and struggle. I think a lot of times people see, as you see shown, your pool and a great life. I don't think they fully understand the sacrifices you've had to make and the financial struggles you've had to endure to get to this place. Give a young fighter a little bit of an insight so they understand that it's not going to be a cakewalk, but if you stay focused, it can happen for you.
Yeah, I mean, back then, I signed a slave contract with a manager back then that took advantage of me. He was from New York. He never came down to Vegas to see how he was living. He put us in the ghetto, you know, no money or nothing. So it was a hard time. But you know, that I'm glad that happened because it's a learning experience that made me tough. That made me stronger. And And after that, you know, I met Floyd, and I think I sparred Andre Durrell back then. 50 Cent, HBO, everybody was there. This was when Floyd fought Cotto for that training camp. So, you know, Floyd liked me, and then he went away on a little vacation. I had to move back to Sweden, and when he got out, I came back to the States. He saw me, and he said, "I want to sign you. I want to buy you out your contract." And no, it was really tough.
Well, let's talk about irony. You just said that you were sparring, I think, Andre Durrell, right?
Yeah.
Now, the irony of that statement is this. In 2015, even though people knew you, you get an opportunity to fight for the super middleweight WBC World Championship belt against the brother, Anthony Durrell. How crazy is that? Talk a little bit about that, because that was your first world title. How did that feel to get that world title and to be able to say all that sacrifice was worth it?
I mean, it was a dream come true, of course, fighting for the title. But, I mean, I knew I was going to be a champion if I get the opportunity to fight for it.
Right.
And, he was a tough guy. He talked a lot of trash before the fight, and that just motivated me. And, I mean, we're cool now. But back then, it was some bad blood, but
Well, I think that's a big part of boxing. I think that, you know, sometimes trash talking happens. And now, in your history, we already understand that you're not about talking. You're about performing. So
I'm about
really
beating your ass.
All about.
And
so here's the great thing about you. You win a world title. You defend your title a few times. And then you decide, you know what? Super middleweight is cool. I want a belt. Let me challenge myself and go to light heavy. Let me see if I can become a two-division world champion. Now, working with you at that time, correct, you're telling me, hey, you know what? I don't want a tune-up fight at light heavy. I want to fight the best. I want to fight a world champion. And so as a trainer, I'm like, okay, let's ease into the water a little bit. You're like, no, I want to fight a world champion. And what do? You get an opportunity to fight for the WBA World Championship light heavyweight world title against Nathan Cleverly. Now, you don't just do it on a regular card. You do it on one of the most exciting, fun cards ever created with Mayweather fighting McGregor, which was not only entertaining, but a huge circus, for lack of words, right?
Yeah.
Explain to me your mindset, why you decided you wanted to fight a champion, and not only did you want to fight a champion, you want to fight a champion on that card.
I mean, there wasn't the plan to fight him, to be honest.
Right.
The plan, we fought James DeGale, so even before that fight, I told Floyd, I can't make the weight no more. And I want to fight Adonis Stevenson. He was the man. He was the ring, the lineal champion. He was the man. He was knocking everybody out. So I said, I want to fight him. And I just fought a southpaw. I just fought DeGale. So, so I wanted to fight Stevenson. But, I think he fought like 2 months before that or whatever. So, he wasn't really interested in that fight back then. And, The next guy available was Cleverly. He actually called me out. I didn't call him out. He called me out. So I was like, why not? And then we got the Stevenson fight after that.
Right, and you went right into that fight, if I'm not mistaken, dominated that fight from round one until they stopped it, right?
Yeah.
And so you walked away, no question whether or not you won that belt, and you got to be on one of the most exciting cards there is with McGregor and Mayweather. Now,
Mayweather and McGregor.
Well, Mayweather and McGregor, right? For those who don't know you, right? If I'm not mistaken, you have the right to correct me. You fought the last eight fights have either been world champions or titled fights. Am I correct?
Yeah, former or future or current world champion. Yep.
Now,
yep.
That, if nothing else, that's a testament of how tough and how committed you are to being the best. And with that being said, I cannot have this interview without discussing one of the most vicious cuts I've ever seen in my life. Yes. I have never seen anyone in any sport have to endure a cut the way you did against Brown. I think that happened in the seventh round.
Yeah, where's it at?
See it now. That's amazing. That's absolutely amazing. Did you have to get plastic surgery for that?
I mean, it's a plastic surgeon that stitched it up, but right. Yeah. No, I just put some, what you call, like a vitamin E gel or whatever on right. It. So
yeah. What the fans want to know, and honestly, I never had a chance to ask you, so I want to know as well. When you got cut in that seventh round, and I really believe that was the skull that we saw.
Yeah.
What was your mind thinking at that time? I mean, the pain that you had to feel had to be just amazing. What was your mind at when you said, you know what, I'm going to finish this fight. Not only am I going to finish this fight, I'm going to finish this fight at world championship status, because you went five more rounds with that cut. What was your mind at that time?
I mean, pain, there's no pain. If you're a boxer, there's no fucking pain. Sorry, right, excuse my French. No, but yeah, I mean, it was hard to see.
True.
So yeah, and I thought the doctor was gonna stop it, right away, but he didn't, and I'm happy he didn't. And I told my corner too, don't stop it. I'm gonna get him. And yeah, it was easier said than done. So it was kind of hard. I mean, he's right. A good fighter, but. Yeah, it wasn't my night either. I had some other issues too, but yeah, no, I couldn't see the whole right. fight. It was right. like a thin, like yellow layer on my eye, so it was a really hard fight. But you know,
I was truly surprised that they didn't stop it. I was truly surprised, and when you got to the back, and I had an opportunity to see it for myself, I could see that it was bad in the ring, but in the back is when I really was able to see how bad yeah. it was. And so from that, to be able to look at your face now and see hardly any scar whatsoever.
I mean, you can see it. It's skin mostly, but yeah, it's a scar, but it's not that bad. It's okay.
Do you happen to remember how many stitches you may have to receive in order to close that?
I think they said like 100. I think 30. It was three layers, so at least like 90.
Yeah, 90 to 100. I remember them saying yeah. about 100 stitches to get it yeah, close in that small area.
Something like
you know,
that, yeah.
The whole world, first of all, respects you in the boxing game. And I personally applaud your warrior spirit. So your last fight you had, and you've shown this in all your fights, that you're a warrior. You never give up mm-hmm. at anything. It was a controversial fight between Pascal, right? Yeah. The whole world kind of questioned it. If you
bullshit.
Were able to get that fight again, would you want it? And if not, is there anybody else you would like to fight?
I want to fight him next, of course.
Well,
that's what I want to fight next, and just, you know, start round 13. But, yeah, I mean, this is a business, so it's all about the money. So
right.
if they come with a big, big money fight, of course I take that one instead. But,
right.
you know, this is how I'll feed my family and – Right. But, yeah, I want that fight next, so, yeah.
Well, I want to speak on something personally that I was able to witness at the end of that fight. I personally thought you won the fight. I personally thought yeah. you got robbed. And I think the team felt the same thing. We go to the back after the fight's over, and the team is upset. You're definitely not happy about the fact that you didn't get the decision. And we're sitting in the room, and the room is kind of quiet. And you look over at us and say, I don't know if you were speaking to me at the time. I thought you were, but it was some people behind me. And you say, go check up on Pascal. Yeah. I was so confused at that point. I'm like, what? We just got robbed? You know, we should have won that. And you say to all of us, go check up on Pascal. Through it all.
Yeah.
Through the confusion, through the disappointment, you were able to look past that and say, I'm concerned about that man and his well-being. That says a lot about you as a person, and I applaud that about you, Badu. I really do. I don't think a lot of people truly understand the sincerity that you have when they call you that humanitarian. There's a reason why the WBC named you as the humanitarian of the year. So I don't want to move forward without giving you an opportunity at this point to let the whole world know what type of things you have in play from that standpoint of being a humanitarian. I know you have a few things you have going on. Explain to the world what you're doing there.
Yeah, so we had we started the Badu Jack Foundation a couple of years ago now. And yeah, we're helping refugee kids all over the world. We started in Jordan. We have a Syrian refugee camp. We have a Palestinian refugee camp. And we do some work in Gambia, where I'm from.